One, two, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, rock. Five, six, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, rock.
Today we're talking to Robin Hope. Robin Hope is a big part of Dion and my life in the fact that he was instrumental in both Dion and myself undertaking our musical career in the direction we took. So welcome to the program, Robin.
Thank you, Cecile.
Robbie, it is true that you've had a big effect on our musical career, but before you actually came in contact with us, you were well on your way to being a musician. So tell us what it was like living in North Beach, was it?
It was.
And that would be in the 1950s?
Yes, I first came acquainted with playing music in public in about 1957 or 58. My mother had been a musician. She played classical violin in a small group. And she also played the mandolin.
I remember her playing that well. She was great.
She was very good.
You had an interest in that as well, didn't you?
Yes, I did learn a bit of it. My mother was keen on me learning piano, learning music properly a few years before that, but I resisted that. I had one or two lessons, but it didn't go anywhere really. And then rock and roll came along, Elvis and so on.
And how did that affect you, Bob?
You know, I thought it was great. It was different, but I was more interested in the instrumental side of it. You know, I'd never heard electric guitar or anything, which I suppose most of us hadn't.
I tell you what, Robin, is that the time you bought yourself some black jeans with silver zips and you bought some fluorescent lime green socks, because I can remember you riding a bike along the road at that time with those beautiful fluorescent green socks.
One lime green and one shocking pink, I think. I was a bit of a bodgy round.
Actually, for those people who are not aware, perhaps we should say that Robin Hope was the musical genius behind our band in the early 60s when we played at the Copycat for many years in a company with Robin, and we couldn't have done it without him. He was quite brilliant. So that's just a little eye-opener for those who wonder where we're coming from as we go into this interview.
Robin, you might be interested to hear that we did an interview with Peter Gillette. He said that part of his inspiration to becoming a musician was listening to the Shamrocks, I believe, in those days. And he said Fred Mummery and yourself, he used to come along and listen, and that's part of the reason that he got started.
Yes, I remember him telling Fred that, as Peter is a keyboard player and he used to come along and listen to Fred on the piano.
Isn't that fascinating? It's funny, Robin, because a lot of the people that we've had on, ranging all the way through from Max Merritt, Peter Southern, even Ray Columbus, lots of them have said that when they started their entertainment career, it was because they were ice cream boys at the movie theatres that Trevor King was running. So they've sort of graduated from the from the ice creams to piano playing and guitar playing. Obviously, that didn't happen with you.
Actually, you mentioned picture theatres there, and Trevor King, one of the early groups that I was in, it included Fred Mummery as well, we were hired to play a bit of rock and roll in the intermission of a rock and roll movie, it might have been The Majestic.
That's interesting how many of the musicians have said that they had their breaks in that type of thing, or even in the supper extras at dances. There were those kinds of opportunities for them as beginners to get out there and do their thing. And who, besides your mother, influenced your playing, Robin?
I taught myself for a while, and I got kicked out of one band because I couldn't play any good, you know, justly so. So I decided I'd better have some lessons from somebody who knew how to teach and what he was doing. And I had a guy called Tommy Carhey recommended to me. I had a year of lessons with Tommy, and I really never looked back after that. He was a brilliant teacher.
He was a brilliant teacher. So many of the musicians who played guitar said they started, even Max Merritt started with Tommy. And I've heard so many interesting things about the dances he ran, and Neil Pickard was talking about how each student had a special program designed so that they would play the stuff that they liked.
Yes. Oh, Tommy, you know, his students idolised him. He was the most kind, patient teacher you would ever get. But the same man I played several times in his band a few years later out at the Operation Deep Freeze base at Harewood, and he was a hard taskmaster with his band.
He expected the best.
He expected the best, yes.
And also Mark Carhey, you had a
brother. Mark, yes. Oh, the Carhey brothers. It was Tommy and Mark and Alex, I think, was the other. Yeah, brilliant. They were the best at pop and rock musicians.
One of the things that I'd like to talk about today, Robin, is some of the joys that we all shared at the Copycat. It was a place that was small and intimate, and an amazing amount of people that fitted in there. And week after week, you used to produce new music.
Yes, I remember when we started there, the proprietor, he was a Yugoslav fellow, Adam Fakadovic.
Adam Fakadovic.
He took us on a trial basis. I don't think he had too much confidence in us because he said, I will not pay you, boys. I will put a door fee on and you take the door fee. So it was all right. But after about a month, I suppose, the place was bulging at the seams when...
I know
we
what you're going to say.
And we were making more money than he was, so he put us on wages.
Yes, I can remember that. I remember we walked into the Copycat one night and we saw, when we were about to leave, we looked out the back and there was Adam counting up all the slips that we'd been taking for our cover charge, and the next week we were on a wage.
Yeah. He says, oh, you're making more money than me, I'll put you on wage.
You've got to remember that you fellas did get a perk because you'd go into the kitchen and eat all the best steaks all the time.
One of the things that I remember from those years, Robin, is a letter that you received from one of the recording companies saying that you were one of the best backing guitarists that they had on their repertoire. Do you remember that?
Yes, they more or less offered me a job as a studio muso, but it would have meant a move to Auckland, and I wasn't, I think I was just married or engaged or something, and I wasn't prepared to do that.
I think another incident that for the listeners would be of great interest is the fact that all the way through playing music in the Christchurch in those years of the 60s and the 70s, we had to work as well during the day. And you worked, was it a foundry that you worked in, Robert?
Yes, I was a moulder in a foundry.
Yes, and you had an unfortunate accident on the very last day that you left your job.
That was quite some time later. That was in the 80s. I had a bit of a mishap and lost a couple of fingers.
That's the part that I wanted to share with the listeners, was the fact of your dedication was such that you turned your guitar around left-handed.
Yes, I bought a left-handed, proper left-handed guitar. It was hard. It took a couple of years of solid practice, but I knew how to do it. It was just a matter of getting my fingers educated.
And so that shows the level of your dedication to your music.
Oh, yes, I like music.
You like music. That's an understatement. You've had such interesting things. I do know, in my back of my memory, all those Shadows numbers that you perfected.
Oh, I still play half the same things now.
You do?
Yeah, I think a lot of that 60s music has got a timeless quality about it. Still sounds good.
Robin, do you remember coming along perhaps with the start of the band to my mother's dancing studio with Fred Mumry and at the same time Cecile, who I'd never met before, came along with Roger Duke. She worked with him and we all got down and jammed in Mum's dancing studio, and from there the band was born for the Copycat.
That's right.
And our trip to Australia. Music in Australia was an interesting time, and life was a little bit tough there for a while. People thought we were a teenage gang because we all had the same coloured jerseys.
With a big S on the front.
Big S on the front.
Yeah.
And I can also recall you and I went on a talent quest there. We thought we were going to take Sydney by storm, and we got on stage. There was a stage of about 2 foot height, and I started to do an Elvis Presley act with wiggling my hips, and the stage collapsed.
Yeah, we didn't exactly set Australia on fire. No.
And I do remember coming home to our little flat in the heart of Sydney. We're about 18 then, I think, and 19 or 20 perhaps. And we'd come back after watching the Lee Gordon show, and we'd get back at about 12:30 at night, and you'd get out your guitar and we'd practice and rehearse Robbing the Cradle by Tony Williams at the middle of the night, and all the flat people were belting on the doors and windows and telling us to shut up. Do you remember that?
Yeah. I used to be quite fanatical about practicing. When I was first learning, I used to get up in the middle of the night to go to the toilet, and I'd get my guitar out and play for 10 minutes or something.
Perfecting a riff.
Much to my mother's delight.
Robin, for many years you did my backing music. I want to take this opportunity to say thank you, because we went a lot of miles, a lot of floor shows, a lot of places around New Zealand, and it was a lot of fun.
Well, I'm taking you back again to the 60s and the Copycat and the times, perhaps, when we had such a joy in the music and the entertainment.
Well, that Copycat was actually quite a unique sort of a thing. It was the first closest thing to a nightclub in Christchurch at the time. It was technically only a restaurant, but everybody used to have the odd little drinkies quietly along with it. And it certainly used to, it used to be absolutely bulging at the seams on Friday and Saturday night.
Yes, it grew, didn't it? Because we started in a little small room, if I remember, and we had two people in the first night, and it gradually expanded from there. And he built in that sort of a stage in the actual place, and then he opened up the roof itself.
Opened up the roof.
So we had them in the interior and on the outside also, and then we moved out to the roof, but it got a bit cold there during the winter.
Yeah. You know, at times there they'd be standing on the stairs, you know, queuing up to for a half an hour to, for somebody to leave so they could get in.
It's fascinating.
Amazing, really.
It is. Robin, looking back over your career in music, have you got some high points, the things that sort of stick out?
Well, you know, music's been good to me. I've done a lot since the Copper Cat days, but I think everything after that was a bit of an anticlimax in some ways. They were great times, really, and it was a great time to be in Christchurch because there was so much talent around then.
It was quite fascinating in the fact that so many young people started there and went all around the world. We hear continuously through this program, 50 Plus and Loving It, different ones that have come home, and New Zealand doesn't even know what they achieved while they were away. One man was talking about being in Abbey Lane in the recording studios recording his music while the Beatles were in recording there. And that recording company were making a decision between his band and another guy called Rod Stewart. And a toss of a coin, it was Rod Stewart, which is fate, yes.
You remember in one of our later bands in Sabra, we had a drummer, Peter Heather, who had actually worked with the Hollies.
That's right, Peter had a double drum kit, and
yes,
when he got on stage, there wasn't
stage.
Enough room for us to get on there, was there? That's right, and again, the bass drums there sort of moved the stage around at times also.
We've had some funny incidents with television and stage shows, and I remember Max Merritt, I actually heard the other side of the story. But through this program, I remember it quite well. We went down to play on the show at the Majestic Theatre. Do you remember that, Robin? And we played our song at practice, and when we went to do it at night, Max and his band had heard it and liked it so much they did it.
Just prior to us coming on, do you remember that? Stole the thunder.
Yeah.
Robin, can you think of a few of the musicians that you've worked with over the years that you'd like to remember now?
I'd like to remember old Fred Mummery.
He was great.
Sadly, he died 20 years ago at quite a young age, but Fred was Christchurch's answer to Fats Domino.
He was great, wasn't he?
Big man, he had that boogie-woogie style of playing. If Fred was alive now, he'd be in demand as a musician for that
style.
That type of playing has come back again.
A bit like Fats Domino type thing.
Yes.
Well, he was a big man and he did have a big presence there at times. You've
and
got
a big
to give
heart.
Him that and a big heart.
Yeah.
If you remember that you fellows used to try to pinch the chips off his plate of steak at the end of the night and he'd whack you, but he wouldn't whack you too hard. None of us could afford to buy the steaks, but he could.
Well, I think one of my fond memories of Fred was that he used to take all of the girls down to the hotel, the Carlton. And he would be the only male present because everyone felt safe with Fred. And he would have a wonderful time with all the ladies there. And while all of the blokes were off doing their thing. And I would love to pay a dollar for every time he took me to or from the venues that we played at. Because once again, Fred was safe and he was the person who looked after me. So it was great.
Yeah. And other people I remember are Murray Johnson, drummer.
Yes, swapped many good experiences with Murray and he always asked to remember to you. And then you haven't forgotten Mike Green played the bass and he was about as high as the bass was high, which was about 5 foot.
He had a beautiful Hofner. He really loved his Hofner and he really got upset one night when Dion backed the van over the top of his Hofner. But because the car was one of those funny little old-fashioned things that didn't weigh anything, what was it?
A Bradford van.
The Hofner was perfectly safe.
It was the only one in the country at the time. It's quite interesting too, the number of times that you meet people from that particular era and you meet them, say, away from New Zealand or in another city and they tap you on the shoulder and you say, hi, remember me from the Copper Cat?
I meet them in Wanganui and says, didn't you used to play at the Copper Cat?
But Robin, I just wanted to remind you of Dion's 21st birthday. I have a vision in my mind's eye of you playing guitar with a rose behind your ear because it was rather late at night. And we had another lady who played the more traditional music, Lottie Duckworth, and it was a kind of a competition between the young rock and roll band and the old staid band to get to play the music. And I've never forgotten that competition that went on between the two of you, and it was a great night.
I think there was a bottle of vodka involved there somewhere. Maybe we shouldn't go there.
I want to thank you very much, Robin, for coming and sharing with us.
Yes, Robbie, I can't let it go by, because it does give me a great deal of joy to remember the wonderful times we had together, all of us, and it really was perhaps the highlight of our musical experience in those days of the Coppercat that we shared with you. So thank you, Rob. It was really great, mate.
It's been a real pleasure. See you later, alligator.